what your definition of happiness today is wholly different from what it was 20 years ago. Hey, maybe 3 days ago. Hello and welcome to the Business of Happiness podcast. I'm your host again, Dr. Tarryn McCarthy. Always so grateful to have you here with me and so grateful for your attention and for your intention to bring happiness into your business and into your life, a pursuit that is such an honorable and worthy one. And I am so grateful to all of you who have been listening to this podcast, and welcome to all of my new listeners, especially welcome to our newest Bee Hive members. Welcome to Erica and Jackie and Maureen into the Business of Happiness Hive, our private Facebook group. Check us out over there. And if this podcast is bringing you value, I know you will find enormous value on the private Facebook group, because it really is an amazing community of people who just really are supporting one another and giving each other great tips and support in terms of how to do this thing called life, how to be a business leader, how to be a leader of your family and a leader of your own dreams, and how to find inner fulfillment along the way. That's the magic. That's the sweet spot. So today, I'm very eager to be sharing with you this phenomenal topic. I've titled it, "It's All About You and It's Never About You." And I know that sounds so contradictory, but it really is fascinating how these twin concepts really support one another in business, in relationships, and in our pursuit of happiness. We're going to talk about why it's all about you can be such an empowering concept. And, you know, initially it sounds extremely selfish, but I'm going to tell you how it's been an empowering and impactful mantra in my life in those three arenas. And then also, it's never about you, how that can be really freeing and very respectful of others when you think of it that way as well. So how are these twin concepts that seem completely opposed actually very interrelated and both powerful in terms of finding success? I'm going to show you some examples, as I mentioned, in my own business, and examples of how these two concepts can be used in your work and in your businesses, and especially in leadership. We're going to talk about in relationships why it's all about you and it's never about you. And then absolutely when it comes to happiness. You know, I used to confuse my worthiness and my value in things that were happening to me, in stories I was telling myself. And I think those were the very fundamental aspects of reaching for happiness, understanding my worthiness and my value. And they definitely play into these two concepts that we're talking about today. I've learned how to see my life differently. I've learned how to integrate these into my life. And, you know, I just feel so passionately about sharing this news so that you can use these concepts in your life as well. You know, I think that along the way, we get told a misconstrued idea of what success is. And it's my mission through this podcast to bring to you some different perspectives. And I know this sounds strange sometimes and antithetical to anything we've ever taken for gospel, but I really appreciate your ability to just think a little bit differently and see if any of this message lands for you. You know, I'm going to start with this concept of it's all about you in business. And I like to start with that because it's controversial. You know, when I say it's all about you, it sounds so selfish, especially when you're someone whose whole purpose is to serve. So many of us are like that. I know so many of you are like that. You're drawn to a profession such as healthcare, dentistry, veterinary sciences, physical therapy, teachers. You know, any of these incredible professions are really all about serving others. And so when I tell you it's all about you in business, everybody's hair stands up. They think, what are you talking about? Everyone tells me all the time that in order to find happiness and success in business, I've got to give, 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 give. How can it all be about me? Well, here is the secret in business and in leadership of why it's all about you. And the reason why is because only you can define success for yourself. When you're creating a business, when you're dreaming a business, when you're dreaming a team of people that you're going to lead to enormous success and impact in the world, it has to be all about you and your definition of success. Even if you're not the CEO of a company, if you're just the leader of your own work ethic and your own work or your own position in a business, you have to decide for yourself what success is. You know, we didn't just come to this place because we didn't know how to work. So many of us know how to work, but the question is, what are you working towards? What is your ultimate definition of success? It's not mine. I can't tell you what that is. You know, this is where we have so many working moms and non-working moms having struggles and power struggles over, are you a stay-at-home mom? Does that make you more worthy than a mom that's a part-time, has a part-time job? Or does that make you less worthy than a mom who has a full-time job and has very little time for her children? This discussion happens. Why? Because we all have unique concepts of what success looks like. And when it feels uncomfortable, when it feels difficult to make that algorithm work, it's because you haven't been listening to your true definition of success. Is it possible to strip away all those old stories and old versions of success that someone else created? You know, very often in the business world, success algorithms were created by men who had a wife at home who was supporting the entire family unit. And so we grew up in this business world as women with this idea of success that somebody else created who wasn't even the same sex that we are and wasn't in the same situation in terms of family, wasn't even in this generation of technology. Our opportunities have changed. This whole algorithm of success has had to change with us, but sometimes we forget to look at it that way. So the truth of the matter is, it's all about you. It's all about your definition of success in business and in leadership and in work. It really has nothing to do with anybody else. And now we're going to flip it. I'm going to tell you why it has never, ever had anything to do with you in business. And where that falls into line is when you try, when you pursue a business and you fumble or you fail or it's not received correctly, it's not about you. It's never about you. You never have to make how the world receives your business and your work about who you are fundamentally as a person. It has no reflection on who you are. It has no reflection even on the potential of your business. It's just a game. And I love thinking about business as a game because it reminds me of one of my values, which I wrap up into my definition of success, and that is I need to find happiness and joy in every day. For me, that's the most important part of my definition of success, is every day finding joy and happiness in every business that I do. So when I think of business as a game, it reminds me to just lighten up a little bit. It reminds me that it's outside of me and it doesn't define my value or my worth on how effective my business plan is. It's just a game and an indicator that I need to change the direction I'm going in. You know, I've started businesses in multiple different arenas, in healthcare, in real estate, now on the online business and in coaching. And I've had to relearn whole new paradigms. And whenever I got myself so wrapped up into thinking that it has any kind of definition of who I am, I faltered. You have to, in business, allow yourself room to take a stab at something you've never done before and get it completely wrong so that you can take a stab in another direction. If you're just always doing what everyone else is doing, you'll never achieve great success in business. You have to go out on a limb. You have to try something crazy and play this game and learn the new algorithm that you're in. You have to find mentors, you have to get advice, but it's all a game and none of it is a reflection of who you are. It's never about you. Just learning to play the game. You know, I have another example of this, and that's in business and in healthcare, and I'm sure many of you can relate to this in terms of any service industry that you're in. We become so passionate about it. We care so much about impacting people in a positive way. And that is so true in my business in orthodontics. I went into orthodontics because I love these smiles and the people behind the smiles so passionately. I just want them to feel great about themselves. I want every patient who walks in the office to feel like it's the best part of their day. That's what gets me excited and gets me so eager to go to work in the morning. And sometimes it's not received that way. I'm not for everyone. Like a good friend of mine says, you're not pizza. Not everyone's gonna like you. So there's occasionally a client or a patient or a customer, whatever service you're in, who's not gonna jive with the way you do things. Not everyone loves an empowering orthodontist. What can I say? I have no idea why not, but not everyone does. Guess what? It's never about you. This mission that you've created for yourself, this dream, the reason you get up every morning and the passion you pour into your work is all about you, and you will deliver great things. But there are going to be some people who are just going through a tough time and are not ready to hear it. Or maybe this just isn't a value of theirs and they just really want to get straight teeth and the least expensive fee possible. They want to show up, get the things moved, and leave, get out of there. And they want no frills or fuss or smiles around it. Just straighten my teeth for me. That person won't love coming into my office. That person won't love all the empowerment and the smiles and the support and the encouragement from my team. They're not going to love the communication online, the communication on the phone and via text. They just want to have efficiency and effectivity with no frills, not going to be a part of my practice. But guess what? It's never about you. It's just about that person. So there's this honoring of what is important to other people. This is where those twin concepts of humility and self-respect come into play. And this is another way of saying it's all about you and it's never about you. It's all about you is that self-respect aspect, recognizing that what really speaks to your heart, what galvanizes you to create a business and to lead a team or to follow your dreams in a specific line of work, that's all about you. That's all about your dreams, and please pursue it. Have some great respect for your passions and your dreams, because that's how you're going to incorporate happiness into your business. And then have compassion and humility and understanding and forgiveness that we're all in this together, but you and I are not 100% alike. Every person has their own priorities and their own struggles that they're going through. And perhaps we even have the same values, but you might be on a different point in your journey. And I see this with some of my patients where I can recognize myself in them. I see where they are is where I was a couple years ago, and I can feel their pain. And even though they're resisting, even though this is uncomfortable for them, I know that they're on their own journey. I can have humility that we're all alike and that we all have within us this potential to find empowerment and happiness within us. So this is that perfect meeting point of humility and self-respect and being able to use those two seemingly opposing concepts as the nugget of truth within your business and your leadership. So how does this relate to relationships? the exact same way. We've even been touching on it a little bit. You know, we wrap so much of our worth up in our relationships unnecessarily without first taking full account of what's important to us in relationships. I think there's some phrases in our society that have actually done us a lot of harm. Things like, you complete me, or my other half, you're my other half. The truth is that we are 100% responsible for our own happiness. I can't expect somebody else to be responsible for my happiness. That's a really tall order. I'm setting someone else up for failure if I'm telling my husband or my best friend or my children that you are responsible for my happiness. No, that's so unfair. And I don't ever want anyone to put that on me. I have no control over my husband's happiness. I really don't. I really can only be 100% responsible for mine. Ask him to be 100% responsible for his, and then we can come together and enjoy one another in that place. And that doesn't mean we don't ask for help. Absolutely. That's where I've had to ask myself the question, what do I want in a romantic relationship? Well, one of the things I really want is communication, so I have to ask for it. What do I want in my friendships? Oh, this is a hard one I've had to ask myself over the past few years, because sometimes our friendships turn into something that we really didn't want along the way, and it's very hard to put those friendships aside for a heartbeat. But it has to happen if you ask yourself, what do I want in a friendship? And I realize that I've actually created something else. It's all about you. What is important for you in the relationships that you have with the people around you? You have to ask yourself that question first, because you cannot expect them to know what you want if you don't even know what you want. And you cannot expect them to know what you need if you don't communicate that to them. There's this beautiful concept of gardening and honing your own garden, imagining your own happiness and your own life as your beautiful garden, and you are responsible for tending to it. You're responsible for pruning and weeding and taking out the relationships that are toxic, taking out the habits that are toxic and hurtful to you. And you're also responsible for planting new ones, for caring for those new relationships, for watering and nurturing those relationships. And your friend, your partner, your children have their own gardens. You can't lean over the fence and water their hydrangeas for them. If you do, you're not taking care of your own garden. I love this concept of each of us caring for our own garden and then meeting at the fence in between and sharing with one another and being so proud of this beautiful garden that we've created. Hear that? Self-respect. Coming to the fence with self-respect. Look at my beautiful garden. I'm proud of who I am. I'm coming to you with joy and openness and so much strength and resource that I can be there for you if you need me. And then so much humility with your garden and what your garden is going through, and leaving judgment at the door. Because we're all in this together, and I've been there. I've been in your position with your hydrangeas. I know what that's like. I know what you're going through. But I'm not going to try to take care of your garden for you. That's your responsibility. I love that analogy because it reminds us of our power and of our strength and our ability to support one another without enabling and without victimizing one another, without stripping each other of our power, because each of us needs that power to be able to take care of ourselves. You should never have to rip yourself into pieces to keep others whole. You shouldn't. You should never have to take away from your own self-respect to lift someone else up, because all that will happen is you'll feel depleted and you won't be available for them when they need you. And this is where we come to the final concept of our pursuit of happiness. And how do these two seemingly opposing ideas of it's all about you and it's never about you come into play when we talk about our journey to self and inner fulfillment? Well, it's all about you is obvious. It's your own journey. And just like we asked ourselves questions when we talked about our business and our relationships, it's important to ask yourself questions about your own happiness as well. What does happiness look like to you? What is your definition of happiness? It's all about your definition of happiness. I love asking this question of my interviews, and if you've listened to many of my episodes, you'll hear that every expert that I've invited on as a guest, this is my favorite question to ask because it's all different. Each of us has a unique perspective of what happiness is. And when we try to live up to somebody else's idea of happiness, that's when we feel like we're fumbling and we're hurting. That's where we feel ineffective or unworthy because we can't deliver someone else's concept of happiness. We can only work on our own. The same is true within our own life. It's important for us to recognize that who you are today, what your values are today, what your definition of happiness today is wholly different from what it was 20 years ago. Hey, maybe 3 days ago. To give ourselves permission to have an evolving sense of happiness. What does happiness look like to you now? And honor that. Because guess what? It's all about you. Your own definition of happiness. And what that really insists on is a lot of patience, a lot of compassion, self-compassion, a lot of forgiveness, but mostly patience with yourself because we're on this journey of life. It's not just that you figure out what happiness is and then you got it and you move on and you're happy for the rest of your days. It's an evolving concept and it's an evolving pursuit. And how does it work that it's never about you? Well, once again, someone else's definition of happiness is never about you. And when you see someone else tripping and skipping and prancing along on the mountaintop and you think, oh my gosh, why are they so happy? I feel so miserable. Remember, it's not about you. And their happiness is not a reflection of your inability to find happiness. It's just their journey that they're on. The same thing is true for someone else if they're not happy. Just because somebody else is in a place of misery does not mean that you need to make yourself miserable to join them. As compassionate mothers and sisters, we do this so often. I've felt this myself in the past where I felt like I needed to prove that my life was as miserable as my friend's when she was going through something difficult. We hear this in our friendship groups whenever we get together and someone says, oh, my husband is such a jerk. And then we start hearing all the other voices, mine too. Oh, you won't believe mine. Yours isn't half bad. Mine is even worse. And I wonder sometimes how much of that is us just trying to bring ourselves down for company within that misery. But the truth is, it's never about you. It doesn't have to reflect negatively about you. It doesn't have to reflect in any way on your own experience. Your happiness is your own business, and it's your own responsibility. Other people's resistance to happiness has been an interesting thing for me to understand because I think happiness is sometimes misunderstood because we each have our own definition of it. So when someone says it's important to be happy, it's important to strive towards happiness, sometimes that sparks a little bit of fear in people. It sparks this idea of an unrealistic expectation. And the truth is, it is just fear. And I've learned to let people just work on happiness on their own journey, and that one day when they're ready for it, they might seek it for themselves. And so just remember to stay on your own path in terms of your pursuit of happiness, and you don't have to affect happiness in others. The same is true for world events outside of your control. You know, there is no reason why we can't find joy in every day, if that's important to you. Even if the world is happening outside of you, even if there are events outside of your control that are hurtful and harmful, you still can strive for happiness, and you deserve to strive for happiness in every day. And believe me, when more of us can do so, we can raise the next generation with this pursuit of empowering themselves with the values that are important to them without having to take on the values of someone else. Once again, I am so grateful to you for thinking a little bit differently and being able to see this other perspective, being able to entertain that it's all about you and it's never about you. And really, there's so much strength and freedom in those twin concepts of humility and enormous self-respect. Know always that I believe in you, and I know that you are worthy of happiness. Wishing you a phenomenal day. Bye-bye.